Thank you. Happy to be here tonight. Always love coming up to this group. Get my water out of the way. Get this turned on. See if we have function. All right. So, you know, we read books and we read magazines and, you know, you read online and you see the scientific names of fish. And a lot of times they're named after people. And we don't always know who those people really are until we start to research that a little bit. So I kind of took that idea and ran with it a little bit with this talk. And it's about people who've had fish named after them or about people who've been important in ichthyology in some way. So we're going to cover a lot of ground. We'll do it more or less in chronological order. It's one of those things that you can't put everybody in. I actually had meant to put a page in on Rosario and a page in on Paul for tonight, but just didn't have time to get it done. Didn't even think about it the last couple of days. I've been so busy. Thought about it, of course, in the car on the way up here tonight. Went, oh, guess it's too late. So we're not going to talk about the two of them, but I think you all know them anyway. So with that said, we'll go ahead and get started. So we're going to start at the beginning, you know, which everyone kind of thinks of Linnaeus as the father of ichthyology or the, you know, as the guy who started a lot of this stuff with classification. But it was really Artaudai and Linnaeus working together. Artaudai is the one who really is known as the father of ichthyology. And the two of them developed the binomial system together, although most of the work was done by Artaudai. Their whole idea was to discuss God's creation and come up with a way to showcase God's creation. You got to remember the times that these people are living in. Religion was everything back then. So it's all about that. And we're going to see that through most of the program, that it all goes back to religion, all goes back to trying to make it line up with, you know, things that they can attribute to God. So it's, you know, the old keep planting corn on father's grave, son, which, you know, we probably all had back in junior high school at some point. I know I did. The kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. But the really interesting thing about this guy, you notice he didn't live very long. He and Linnaeus were, in addition to working together, they were drinking buddies. And he died by drowning in a canal one night on the way home from the bar. He was out drinking with Linnaeus. Linnaeus made it home fine. He didn't. So the thought is that, in all likelihood, Linnaeus killed him. And Linnaeus took his work and published it as his own. So, still one of these days I'm going to get around to reading that book. I still have not done that, but I want to. But it's a novel. It's really not accurate, I'm sure. But thought this was kind of neat. And he really was a total fish fanatic. He was like, you know, the first fish geek in terms of really getting everything described and figured out. So that leads us into Linnaeus, or Carl von Linné, who obviously lived a little bit longer. So nobody drowned him in a canal. Son of a pastor. And again, it's all about religion. And his whole idea here is to reveal God's creation. Considered to be a very accomplished scientist, and, you know, we owe him a debt of gratitude today, but again, I think some of the things that we owe him a debt of gratitude for were not really his ideas, they were Artaudai's. But Linnaeus, you'll see his name on all kinds of fish, you know, as the original person describing them, because he really did more of that. Actually a botanist by trade to start with, and then he worked, got into fish through Artaudai. Peter Farskall was kind of the next one, and he was a student of Linnaeus. You'll see a lot of things, too, with a lot of these gentlemen will, and there's actually a few women in here as well, but a lot of them studied a lot of different things. They didn't really just specialize in one thing like we have a tendency to do today. You know, he's studying Oriental languages, studying philosophy, you know, was one of the best-known Orientalists of his day, which, you know, we wouldn't even use that term today. It's kind of politically incorrect. Died of malaria collecting specimens in Yemen on a mission. Not just fish, but they were out to collect all sorts of things. Several of his books were published after he died, and there was only one person who survived that trip to Yemen. The rest of them all died on there. So, you know, it was an adventure to travel back then, not like it is today. Of course, today I don't know that I'd still want to go to Yemen very much either. So. Lamarck, really probably one of the great minds in history. You know, it's you've got a few people that really stand out historically in this talk, and not just in fish, but in a lot of ways, and he's one of them, and he's, you know, really one of the true giants. But one of the things that was really interesting, he kind of, this was before the whole idea of evolution, and we're talking about a lot of things that preceded that, and, you know, you'll see later how Darwin kind of took things together and made a whole out of it. But his idea was that animals could learn things, and that the traits and the things that they learned, they could pass on. You know, that idea really caught on for a little while, but then it went out of fashion. And as we're seeing today with the work being done on retroviruses and things, where they can mutate and they can learn new things, and then the things that change and the things that they mutate into, they pass on. So actually, we're starting to see people, you know, Neil Lamarckists and ideas that he presented way back when becoming popular again now. We're seeing that there is actually some truth to what he saw. It's just that science was not at a point where it could demonstrate any of that for the last few hundred years. Now, one of the things that he did think about, too, is that animals transmuted. You know, it was transmutation. It was not that animals went extinct, but that they changed form into something else. You know, there's some element of that is true as well. You know, you can kind of see that, hey, you know, a lot of our birds and stuff today are descendants of dinosaurs. But that doesn't mean that the dinosaurs didn't go extinct, because they still did. So, yeah, you know, he's got some good thoughts, but they were kind of, you know, and he was ahead of his time for the way he was thinking. But we know now that, you know, while some of the stuff is true, a lot of it's just not. And he and Cuvier argued a lot. He was not a very religious person. So he was on the outs with a lot of people in his day simply for that reason, that he was not a big believer in the idea that God created everything and, you know, that's just how it was, but he believed that animals could transmute and change and continue to survive. So, Jeffrey St. Hilaire, one of his disciples, his biggest work was on Nile crocodiles, but he was professor of vertebrates at the National Museum of Natural History, and he believed the species could be modified by their environment. And what he really liked to do and what his big contribution at the time was to study homologies. He looked for ways in which animals across different types, you know, very differing types, were similar. So most of his work was done studying embryos. And, you know, we've all taken enough science at this point to know as the embryos grow, even human embryos are very much like some of the lower animal embryos. So he's showing how these are connected. And in his words, they're programmed to ascend. That the higher mammals are programmed to ascend from lower forms of life. I'm not sure that how true that is, but, you know, an interesting idea, especially for the time. Again, you're talking about the late 1700s and into the 1800s. So we didn't have a whole lot of scientific knowledge yet. And then we get to Cuvier. Cuvier is generally considered one of the greatest minds in history. This was a man with fascinating, phenomenal intellect and interested in everything and anything. I'd never thought about that. Yeah, kind of does. We need to paint Angela in there. So, but he had a very large lab in Paris. Where he had all sorts of students, you know, at the National Museum of Natural History in Paris, all sorts of students working under him, doing all sorts of different work. Probably even better known for his work with fossils, with fossil fishes and fossil dinosaurs, than he was for his work with living fish. Although, if you, he's got from the 18, there's a book series that's got drawings and paintings of a lot of fish that were alive at the time that he put out that's really interesting. He's considered to be the father of paleontology. He's one of the first people to suggest that Earth had once been dominated by reptiles. You know, you think about it, this is a time when they're really starting to dig up bones, and they're starting to dig up a lot of bones, and, you know, whether they're quarrying chalk or they're quarrying whatever, they're finding bones. And trying to figure out what those represent, you know, where they were from, what happened to those animals, why aren't they around now? So he was really really influential in that. And then as you see at the bottom, he thought that a series of floods wiped out life on Earth. One of his ideas was that God continually recreated things. So he'd have a giant flood and wipe things out because they weren't quite right, and he'd do it again. If he wasn't quite happy with it, he'd do the same thing over and over again until he finally got it to where he wanted it. And we know now, you know, from being able to study geology, that that just couldn't have been the case. There weren't worldwide floods, and certainly not any number of them like he envisioned. But just a great mind and a big influence on a lot of people who came a little bit later. Johann Baptist von Spix, again, studied theology, philosophy, and medicine. Didn't study zoology, but he developed an interest in it. And then he went to study with Cuvier and Saint-Hilaire in Paris, and went back to Munich, was a member of the Austrian expedition to Brazil from 1817 to 1820, went all the way up the Amazon to Peru, and then up the Rio Negro, collected thousands of specimens, died of what's described as nervus typhus, which he contracted in Brazil, which is not schistosomiasis, because that doesn't exist in South America. So I'm not sure what he died of, but that's kind of what the literature says, is it might have been schistosomiasis, but it's wrong. And he died before he was able to classify all his fish. So that fell to someone else, whom we will get to shortly. But there's, I mean, think about this. In 1817, he's making that trip. There's not many people now that would make that trip. So that's pretty impressive. And, you know, you can see why these journeys to South America took years. You know, when they're talking about traveling thousands of miles on rivers, and it's taken them months to get there and months to get home, it's a pretty amazing thing that they endured. Carl Friedrich Philipp von Martius was his partner in working on things, and was his partner on the trip, and brought back 6,500 species of plants from Brazil from that same trip. He's a professor in Munich. His students included Louis Agassiz, whom we'll meet shortly, and Alexander Braun. After Spix's death, somebody had to do something with all those fish, and that turned out to be Agassiz, and von Martius is the one who gave the fish to Agassiz to work on. Interesting, too, he was the first one to group plant growth, to group plants by the way their leaves grew. And today they really group more by how the flowers grow than how the leaves grow, but it was still a very interesting way to start, and very logical in a lot of ways. And if you think about it, too, in addition to the fact that he described a number of things, the ruffled sword plant is Martii, which is named after him. And his herbarium had over 300,000 specimens of 65,000 species. And can you imagine? That puts all our fish rooms to shame. Johann Natterer, another member of the Austrian expedition to Brazil. He was the zoologist, but he stayed there for 17 years. Traveled throughout Brazil, through up the Rio Negro, into Peru, probably went into Ecuador. Didn't return to Europe returned with 1,671 species of fish and over 1,100 species of mammals. I mean, just imagine that. 1,100 species of mammals he collected. You're talking... Yeah, roughly, 4,000 species that he collected while he was there. And he was the first European to collect discus, which is why, they're named after him. And Heckel. Director of the fish collection at the museum in Vienna. He did not travel. He was a homebody. He did not want to be bothered. He did not want to go anywhere. He liked to just be at home and be in all his comforts, and preferred to just work on specimens that were brought back by other people. So he worked with Cuvier, Valenciennes, and others, basically anyone at the time that could provide him with specimens he was willing to work with. And, of course, Symphysodon discus was described by him, which is why we call it the Heckel discus. Achille Valenciennes. Man, he looks mean, doesn't he? he was in France, worked with Lamarck, Saint-Hilaire, and Cuvier, and it's really that 22-volume Natural History of Fish. It's pretty impressive work. After Cuvier died, he's the one who completed it. His primary work in his own career was with parasitic worms, which are very important in parasitology. And he really took a lot of Cuvier's work with fossils and tried to link fossils to current species. So really looking for those changes and looking for what ways fish adapted. Far more interested in facts than hypotheses. But didn't do any real traveling either. He's another one that was a homebody, liked the comforts of home. So he was quite content to work with the specimens that other people collected. Then we get to Louis Agassiz. And this is another one, I think, of the really great minds in history. A lot of things about this guy. You know, we've got all sorts of fish named after him. He described a lot of them himself as well. But apart from his work with ichthyology, he created really the modern teaching method. You know, the way classes were taught at this time, basically a professor stood up there and read. He didn't believe in that. You know, he'd give each student, you know, some type of an animal, of a dead animal, and have them study the animal for 3 days and not talk about anything else, not look at anything else, not use a microscope, not use anything. Just study the animal and figure out how it worked and what it did and how it was adapted to live the way that it did. Really interesting stuff. But his family wanted him to be a doctor, and he didn't want to be a doctor. He wanted to be a naturalist, so he took as many classes as he could justify taking in the fields that interested him while still taking medical classes. Got typhoid. Alexander Braun was his best friend. So he went to Alexander Braun's home to recuperate from the typhoid, where his sister Cilly, took care of him, and they fell in love, later married. Much to Alexander Braun's dismay, he did not want him marrying his sister. He knew it would not be a good thing for his sister, and that's really the way it turned out. Now, you know, something that's very much like what some of us might do today when they chose to study in Munich. One of the reasons he went there was the plentiful supply of excellent beer. See, as good a reason as any to go to college, right? Studied under Martius, and then, you know, Martius gave him the fish to work with after Spix's death. So he published Fishes of Brazil at age 23. He's a pretty smart guy, pretty devious mind here. The big giant of the time was Cuvier. He'd never met Cuvier. He dedicated his book to him, which got him an introduction with Cuvier. Cuvier immediately took to him and gave him a corner of his lab in Paris to work on the fossil fishes, gave him all the fossil fishes to do the work on that. So, his book on fossil fishes came out and was very well received. He was originally from Neuchâtel in Switzerland. He did go back there. Kind of started a publishing business there, which was a major failure. This is one of those guys that brilliant mind, but no head for the real world at all. I mean, if you keep him in academic circles, he could do anything he wanted to do. Anything he thought about doing, he could do. Basically, everything he touched turned to crap. Almost everything he did failed. He never had any money. As much money as he made on books and things like that, he spent more money than he had coming in. Was always in debt. Huh? Yeah, this is the guy with the beer. Yeah, well, yeah. Maybe that might be why. He might have had a little too much. Yeah. But, yeah, he was always, you know, he always was hiring artists. He had assistants. He was everywhere he ever lived, basically became a laboratory, became a living laboratory. He had all kinds of preserved specimens as well as live stuff, all sorts of animals living there and eating each other because they weren't really compatible. Just crazy stuff. He was one of the interesting things about him too was that he was the first one to propose the concept of an ice age. You know, as he was touring Europe and looking at the deposits of rock and things, and just made sense to him that this had happened. You know, nobody else had thought that, even though they'd all looked at the same things. They just didn't look at things the same way that he did. Really had a different mind. He did go on a lecture tour of America, which was very well received. He became a professor at Harvard. You can still go to the Harvard Library, and you can actually look at his books and his notes and all that stuff. It's there and available. He established a Museum of Comparative Zoology at Harvard, and his lifelong dream was to go to South America, which he was finally able to do as part of the Thayer expedition. Traveled through Brazil and then went to the Galapagos. The other interesting thing with him, you know, again, daughter of a clergyman or son of a clergyman, just everything had to be seen through God. Everything was tied back to God. Argued with Darwin about everything that Darwin ever suggested. Just couldn't go along with any of it. Even though much of his own research supported Darwin's position, he couldn't do it. You know, he gets very excited when he finds gars in the United States that are a link between gars that are extinct and gars that are around now. So again, you know, theory of evolution being supported right there, but nah, he wouldn't go that far. The one negative here, I think we got, nope, we got Darwin next. One negative on him is late 1850s, or right before the Civil War broke out, he did a lecture tour in the South in which he really went on and on about his idea that there were multiple races of human beings and that black people were inferior to white people, and that made him very popular there. He stayed in Charleston for quite some time because he was so popular there because of those thoughts and his willingness to express them. He did later come to kind of regret that and realize that he was wrong and didn't stay in Charleston, went back up to Harvard. But, you know, you get the good with the bad. Charles Darwin. I actually didn't originally have Darwin in this talk, but I kind of mentioned him so many times it seemed like we needed to add him in. And very much like Agassiz, his father wanted him to be a doctor, although his father was a doctor. He didn't want to do that. He wanted to be a naturalist. And his whole idea growing up was that he wanted to be a parson naturalist. You know, again, he's a very religious guy growing up, more so even than most of the rest of his family. The Darwins were long known as a family that didn't really follow too closely with what the church did. They were Reformationists and, you know, all kinds of stuff that was frowned upon. But to him, the idea that you could be out in a country parsonage and have a lot of free time to go out and collect beetles or, you know, do whatever it was that you wanted to do was very appealing. So, you know, he continued down that track for a while, went to Christ College, had the opportunity when he graduated from Christ College to go on the Beagle from 1831 to, well, was from 1831 to 1836, but he didn't know that at the time. His father would not give him the money because part of the deal with going on the Beagle was he had to pay his own way. They needed a naturalist, and they were willing to take a naturalist that was unproven, but it needed to be someone who would pay their own way. His father was one of the most successful doctors in the region, was a very wealthy man, but would not give him the money to do that. He went to his uncle, and his uncle thought it was a great idea for him to do that. It would be a super experience for him, and convinced his father to do it. So he was able to go on the voyage of the Beagle. Now, interestingly, on the Beagle, a lot of the things that we think about with him, you know, the whole thing with the finches and Galapagos and, you know, how they're all adapted to living on the individual islands and they're adapted to whatever their diets are, the fact that there's different tortoises on each of the islands in the Galapagos, he didn't really pay any attention to that. He sent a lot of specimens back to England, but all his bird specimens from there were not really well documented, and he almost invariably thought they were something other than what they were. He sent back tortoises, but he didn't label which island they came from. They took 200 tortoises on the boat with them as food, and everybody on the boat was talking about how the tortoises were different, you know, on each island. He didn't pick up on it. He's eating them, and then they're throwing the shells overboard instead of keeping those, even just the shells, to send back and be able to track which ones are from where and how they're different. So you know, he kind of started out a little dim, I think, in some ways. But he caught on pretty quickly. Once he got back and started really working through the specimens, you know, a lot of things became clearer. Now, a lot of the specimens he brought back, too, he didn't work on himself, but he sent them out to other people, you know, who were more expert in the field and, you know, had more information and more knowledge about birds or about whatever it was. But he took all that back, you know, took all that information back as he got it back and really started to think a lot on the origin of species. And, you know, it all started to gel, but it was a long time before he published. You know, he had this idea for decades before he published it. He was scared to death of what the public reaction was going to be. You know, he knew this is a very religious society, and he was about to set it on its ear. So he held back for a long time. His wife was very religious. His wife was actually afraid for his soul because she thought that God was going to punish him for this. She actually wrote him a letter that she gave him the day before they got married about how fearful she was for his soul. And his wife was, of course, his cousin, which, you know, was not uncommon back then. He had a lot of health issues, passed a lot of those on to his children. Some of the work that he did later in life was geared toward trying to figure out how close those relationships could be and what impact that would have on the children, because it was really directly related to his family. But published a number of books, more and more outlandish in terms of how they relate to religion. It took a long time after they were published for them to really become generally the way things were considered to be. He was, like I said, he was very sick. He had a lot of stomach issues, a lot of problems, and he was into really crazy cures, cold water cures, and, you know, going out and having people throw cold water on him in the morning, and yeah, doing all kinds of crazy stuff. Really, his health suffered, I think, in part because he was so worried about what was going on and what the reaction, the public reaction was going to be to him. But it really turned out that, for the most part, it wasn't anywhere near as severe as he thought it was going to be. He did become a, you know, greatly regarded person of his own time, member of a lot of different royal societies, really became known as somewhat of a recluse. He really wasn't. But he didn't like to go out in public because, again, he was afraid of what reactions he might get. And he kind of got, as he got older, he got to the point where he didn't want to go somewhere if he wasn't receiving an award. And if you're giving him a reward or an honorary degree or something, he'll come and see you. But otherwise, he doesn't want to. Carried on an incredible correspondence with people all over the world about all sorts of esoterica that's all reflected in his books. Always working on books. He finishes one, he goes to another one. Some projects he, you know, drops in terms of another book and then goes back to them. Did all kinds of work with barnacles, all kinds of works with all sorts of things. Really an interesting guy. If you are into reading biographies, I would really recommend you go find one or two on him and read them. It's amazing all the stuff that he did. Richard Schomburg. 1811 to 1891, was a gardener for Peter the Great, a member of the British-Prussian expedition to Guyana and Brazil from 1840 to 44, commissioned by the Prussian government to collect specimens of flora and fauna for the Royal Museums and the Botanical Gardens in Berlin. Later emigrated to Australia, became director of the Adelaide Botanical Garden, and created one of the world's largest living plant collections with more than 8,500 specimens. You'll usually read references to the Schomburg brothers when you read about him in relation to aquatic stuff. But really, it was Richard that was the driving force in that. So he's the one we include here. Yeah, interesting guy. Steindachner, again, a lot of fish named after him, and he described quite a few. Another one that really started out working with fossil fishes more than anything else. Went to Harvard to work with Agassiz, member of the Hassler expedition that circumnavigated South America. You know, you got to remember that the ships, these guys are sailing in wooden ships. You know, that was a heck of a voyage. And you know, just like the Beagle's voyage, and the Beagle's voyage was made even crazier by the captain, by Fitzroy, who just couldn't let things go. Had to keep going back and checking things. It took a lot longer than it was supposed to, but he did eventually go back to Vienna, and wound up being the director of the museum. But he described hundreds of fish. Cope, paleontologist, herpetologist, ichthyologist, and comparative anatomist. Again, these guys do all sorts of different things. He attended Harvard either for a year or two. Things are not really really clear how long he was there. Became professor of zoology at Haverford, which is actually where I went my first couple of years as well, despite his lack of schooling. Wrote over 1,400 papers. Discovered 56 species of dinosaurs. Dinosaurs were really his first love. Described hundreds of species of fish. Had a feud with Marsh, who was another paleontologist, about the bones and the species they were finding and describing. He brought back a lot of Lamarck's ideas. And the Journal of the Society of Herpetologists and Ichthyologists is named after him, Copia. Mary Kingsley is the first woman we have in our program tonight, and I love her. Picture her as Mary Poppins. Picture Mary Poppins running around equatorial West Africa, and that's Mary Kingsley. That's how she dressed in Africa. But she had a sickly father, and, you know, at that time, the men were in charge. She had to do what he wanted her to do because he was her daughter. Or she was his daughter. And what he wanted her to do was stay at home and take care of him. Even though she wanted to travel, she was not allowed. He eventually died, at which point she became under the wing of her brother. And her brother wouldn't let her travel, despite the fact that she really wanted to go. She really wanted to go to Africa, but was not allowed to do that. And the brother got married, and he went on a honeymoon. While he was on a honeymoon, she left. She saw her chance, and she took it. First European to visit much of the great forest in West Africa. Had numerous encounters with all sorts of animals and with cannibals. She was opposed to the idea of imperialism. But during the Boer War, she did offer to nurse English soldiers, but they rejected her. They didn't want her because they didn't like her ideas. So she nursed Boers instead. And while she was doing that, she caught a fever and died. Buried at sea with military honors. Fish probably did eat her, yeah. David Starr Jordan, interesting guy. We started actually seeing some more of my my connections to some of these people, too, with this one. He was a member of the first graduating class at Cornell. With a degree in biology, or in botany. Went up and studied with Agassiz a bit, was inspired to study ichthyology by him. Joined the natural history faculty at Indiana University, which is where I graduated from in 1879. Jordan Hall there is the biology building at IU. Was president of IU from 1885 to 1891. He was the youngest president of a university in the country. And the first president at Indiana that was not an ordained minister. When the Stanfords wanted to start, and I have Stanford University spelled wrong in there. How the heck did I do that? Yeah. And I've done this talk a number of times and never noticed that before. But they chose him as president, huh? What? Yeah. That's it. Yep. Yeah. When they started Stanford University, he was hired as the first president there, and eventually served as chancellor, was elected president of the NEA, and I think we have another page on him. Yeah. So he was really the driving force in establishing the Hopkins Marine Station, which is part of Stanford, and testified as a witness for the defense in the Scopes trial. We can all thank him for that. But then we get into the interesting stuff. Jane Stanford was murdered in 1905 in Hawaii by poisoning. 1906, I'm sorry. Before they called the cops, the people who discovered her body called him. He immediately went to Hawaii and covered it up. Now, there is some real thought out there that he was responsible for it in the first place. He was fighting with her in particular, but with the Stanfords in general, but her in particular. She wanted him out. She wanted him gone. She did not want him at Stanford anymore. And suddenly, in the midst of all that, she ends up dead. Mm-hmm. But yet, on the other hand, he was a peace activist. Yeah, so. And then the fisheries research ship, David Starr Jordan, was commissioned for service by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service in 66 and later served in the NOAA fleet. So, interesting guy. Carl Eigenmann. Born in Germany, emigrated to America, attended IU the year that Jordan was appointed a professor, and quickly became his star student. His first paper was on darters. Eigenmann Hall is a dormitory at IU. You know, the whole time I was at IU, I never realized that connection with Jordan and Eigenmann, that you know, these were the same guys that I'd read, you know, their names in fish books. Never put that together. But when he got married, he went to California. His wife was from California. They stayed in California working. Then they did go to work with Harvard, at Harvard under Agassiz. Did extensive work on his fish collection from the Thayer expedition. And there's his wife. She worked on the fish he brought back from the Hassler expedition. Preliminary notes on South American nematognathii, which is catfish. Worked on cave fishes. Continued to work on fish that he collected and those brought back by others. She, again, did not do a whole lot of traveling, although she did certainly do some. And she was the first one to propose a land connection between Africa and South America. You know, the first one to really make that connection because of the fauna and the flora. Now, of course, we know it's all true, but they didn't have any clue back then. William Innes, you know, one of the greats of the American aquarium hobby. Really active member of the Aquarium Society of Philadelphia. Started out with his interest in goldfish. The society in general at that point was a goldfish society. There really weren't many people in the Philadelphia area keeping tropical fish. That was more up here in New York and Chicago and other places. But Philadelphia actually at the time was known for some of the best goldfish in the world and maybe the best in the world. It was really the hotbed of goldfish. But his biggest contributions to the hobby in certain ways are probably as a publisher, as a printer. That was the family business. He published all the Innes books, the Exotic Aquarium Fishes series. Actually, the original ones were written by someone else whose name is escaping me at the moment. Oh, I'm drawing a blank. It's in Al Clay's History of the Aquarium Hobby, though, the toy aquarium, if anyone is interested in knowing more about that. One of his big changes in the big techniques that he advanced with fish books and things was the way he did his fish photography, and the way that they put the photographs into the books. That really was new and different. Charles Tate Regan, or C. Tate Regan, or Reagan, depending on how you want to pronounce it. It's one of those things, when you're pronouncing scientific names that are named after a person, you pronounce it the way the person's name would be pronounced, with the I or the E on the end, depending on what it is and how you want to pronounce it. And again, on this one, I've never been quite sure if it's Regan or Reagan. So is it Gelidochromis regani or Gelidochromis regani? Don't know. It's regani? Okay. That's how we say that, so that would make it Charles Tate Regan. She would know. She's next. So, served as director of the British Museum of Natural History from 1927 to 1938. He worked there from 1901 to 1938, 37 years working the same place. His work was primarily with fishes. Published a number of books on fishes of England and Ireland. Worked on scientific results of Scottish National Antarctic Expedition and the British Antarctic Expedition. And was Trovas's mentor. And there she is. She was a senior scientist in the fish section of the British Museum for over 50 years. Best known for her work with African cichlids. You can't read about mbunas and fishes from Lake Malawi without reading her name. You know, and some of the nicest fish to come out of the lake are Labiatrophius trovasi. Described 6 genera of mbuna with 27 genera of haplochromines, and some of them with David Eccles. Published more than 120 scientific and popular articles and books, and was one of Ad Koning's mentors. So, tremendously influential woman. And, you know, a lot of those 6 genera of mbuna now have been divided further based on tooth structure and, you know, all sorts of different things. It seems like those have changed quite a bit here in the last 10 years or so. Ongoing. George Barlow, whom we lost just in the last decade, studied under Conrad Lorenz. Interested in the genetic underpinnings of behavior as well as the mechanisms of learning. Really worked closely with cichlids on behavior of fishes. Has books on behavior of fishes, has books on cichlids. Heavily involved in the Richard B. Gump South Pacific Biological Research Station on Moria. Wrote 163 papers and 3 books. Yeah, Paul, you want to say it loud? I heard you, but I'm not sure everybody did. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Ooh, Tinwin, as Yanni mentioned earlier, Tinwin was a scientist, was a professor of chemistry at the University of Yangon University, which the old Rangoon is now Yangon. Interested in the taxonomy and distribution of fishes of Myanmar, and wrote a lot of articles regarding his new discoveries as well as taxonomic and nomenclatural changes. He kind of became known as the fish guy around Rangoon. You know, foreigners would come into the country and would ask about fish, and they'd send them to talk to him. And people would go to the university and find him, and he'd take them back to his house and, you know, show them all his fish and just, you know, really friendly, really nice guy. Started Hein Aquarium in 1998 with the idea of trying to introduce some of the fishes of Myanmar to the rest of the world. And the whole explosion in new species of danios and betas and darios and all those things that happened in the 2000s was really in large part thanks to his efforts. And Danio margaritatis, he called the galaxy danio. Yes, not the celestial pearl danio. No, the galaxy danio. You know, there's some problems with the scientific description of that fish because Roberts really rushed that description into press of that species because he wanted to assign a common name. He wanted to assign it the common name of celestial pearl danio. Scientists don't get to assign common names. Scientists assign scientific names. Exporters, importers, hobbyists assign common names. It's a galaxy danio, as far as I'm concerned. I'll never use the other name. I just think it's ridiculous. So, anyway. And no, you know, Danio Tinwini is not named Danio Teeny-Weeny. I've actually had many people ask me that. Yeah, when that fish first came out, I got the first ones in. It's, oh, it's a little tiny fish. They named it Teeny-Weeny. No, they didn't. So, Gunter Sturba, born in 1922. I tell you, I keep threatening TFH that I'm going to sit down and write an article for them entitled Everything I Need to Know I Learned from Innocent Sturba. You know, and really, when you look at Innocent's books and you look at Sturba's books, yes, some things have changed from when they were written to now. But really, all the basics and everything you need to know to be successful in an aquarium is in those books. And the identification of species, the information on how you breed different things. Sturba's book in particular is phenomenal on breeding stuff. really has a lot in it. I've got the, you know, the multiple volume and the smaller one as well. And they're books I look at a lot. Yes, Freshwater Aquarium Fish of the World was one of the two most influential books of the formative stage of the hobby. The other one being Innes's Tropical Aquarium Fishes. Yeah, I was a professor of zoology at the University of Vienna, and then went to Karl Marx University in Leipzig, where he became director of the Zoological Institute. And I did. Wow. Man, this must have been late when I was working on this. It's like the fifth time I've done this talk, and I didn't catch that. That's no, they weren't. Only once was in Pennsylvania. No, actually, that's not true. Twice in Pennsylvania. Okay. Controversial figure here. We're not going to ask Rosario or Paul to tell us stories about him. I do not. If I could find one, I would put it in there. But I'll tell you what, you know, at the end of the day, when you look at it, he screwed a lot of people, and he did a lot of wrong things, and he went to jail for it. But on the other hand, if you just look at it as what he did for fish, you know, TFH Publications is responsible for the hobby and a lot of us. You know, reading TFH Magazine, reading all those books, you know, reading all those articles on collecting that made you want to go to wherever that was. I know it was really important for me, especially when I was younger. You know, he introduced a lot of fish into the hobby. You know, he did a lot of things that were good and a lot of things that were negative. I'll tell you, I had the opportunity to meet him a number of times, and you know, his PhD was actually in music. And he used to come out to Indianapolis for the violin competition that's out there every few years. And when he was out there, he'd speak at our club at the Indianapolis Aquarium Society. And he was always just an incredibly nice guy to us. So, but, you know, we were not treated the way a lot of other people were, apparently. So, anyway, Ibel Ibesfeld, another really kind of a great mind that's not well known in fish. He's got one fish named after him. You know, studied and worked with Lorenz, but he was diving with Hans on the Zarifa, which was journeyed throughout, particularly the Indian Ocean, when he was there, Indian Ocean, Pacific, but most of the Indian. But really doing all kinds of different things. You know, he's considered to be the founder of the field of human ethology, which focuses on the evolutionary and adaptive significance of human behavior in comparison to animal behavior. The head of the Max Planck Institute for Behavioral Physiology. You know, just a fascinating guy. And I found, you know, reading his book on his experiences with the Haas expedition, I found it really fascinating what he said about the Centropyge Iblei. And I just want to give you all a minute or so to read that. It's kind of an amusing little anecdote. Everybody good? Okay. We're going to get into a little more, another controversial figure here. But we'll start in earlier generations. Adolf Kiel there in the picture in the lower left. Who really worked with water plants in Germany. Was one of the first to really push aquarium plants and turn it into a big business. And then his daughter, who took her children and went to South America with them. And that book, River of Hope, by Tinez River of Hope, is a phenomenal read. I would highly suggest everybody get that book and read it. It's just really a great story about their time in South America. That's actually Heiko on the right. Yeah. Big snake that they caught, and it's her at in Brazil, where they were growing plants. But you know, Heiko's another one. Heiko turns a lot of people off because he can't stop telling you how wonderful he is. If Heiko would stop telling you how wonderful he is, a lot of other people would tell you how wonderful he was. He's another one who's really done more traveling around the world than probably any of us can even begin to imagine doing, and found and introduced more species into the hobby than just about anybody else. You know, the whole interest in rainbow fish is because of Heiko. You know, Heiko found a lot of that stuff and brought it back in, got it distributed to the rest of the world. Some Australians knew about the Australian stuff, but they might not have known so much about the Papua New Guinea ones. And he's still finding new rainbows in the last year that we'll be seeing at some point. You know, worked in all sorts of different levels in the hobby. You know, worked at Gulf Fish Hatchery, had Aquarium Rio, exported fish from Brazil, was set up in Germany, imported and exported from Germany. That's the Heiko Mobile, you know, which he took around the world collecting fish. There he is with some monster Altum Angels. And he's really a proponent of the biotope aquarium at this point. He really pushes that big time. And I think that there's a lot to be said for that idea, rather than trying to, you know, replicate some terrestrial environment in your aquarium. I never understood that. But trying to set up a aquarium like with as close to what would be natural conditions for the fish as possible. I think you're going to see some different behaviors and things that way. You might be a little more likely to spawn fish that way, too. Bless you. And then, just a little bit about my old friend Rusty Wessel. I've known Rusty for longer than probably either one of us wants to admit. This is actually from a slide from a different presentation, from a fish trivia quiz, but Therops Wesseli is the one on the bottom. Rusty's another one, travels extensively throughout Central and South America, really interested in the cichlids and live-bearing fishes, in particular those two areas, and has introduced a number of things into the hobby, including a number that were in the hobby years ago and were lost to the hobby, and he's brought them back. And that's our last one.